we need to discuss also on the communicable diseases regarding the meningitis. So this is anatomy of and the central nervous system. This is the layer that we see. So the meninges consists of three layers that provide the protections, cushioning, and support to the brain and spinal cord. So we have here the dura mater. We have the peristyle layer. We have the meningeal layer. We have also here the arachnoid mater. So yan. So makikita po natin yan. So I will discuss clearly sa mga susunod na slides natin. So meningitis is a notifiable diseases. The exact incident rate is very unknown. So but in 2010 there are 420 deaths and in 2013 there is 303 deaths. So it occurs as a complications of other diseases and there is a 50% is an opportunistic infections. So very alarming in terms of the meningitis kasi yung meningitis natin, the other term that is tinatawag natin siyang cerebrospinal fever. Okay? So in the newborn, there are 20 to 30% may die from the bacterial meningitis. There is also a risk is lower in the older children. So usually nag-arise na siya during the adulthood because 66% of all the cases emerge without the disability. So the main problem here is the deafness, that is 14%, and the cognitive impairment, that is 10%. Okay, so this is the meninges. So we can see the meninges are the layers of our tissues that separate the skull and then the brain. Okay, let's start with the definitions of meningitis. So meningitis, that is inflammations or infections of the membranes or the meninges that surrounds the brain and then the spinal cord. So it can cause by the ingestions of poisons or drugs as well as the injections of the certain substances. It may also due to the reactions to vaccines or a pathogen. Okay, there is a route of entry in the central nervous system. It can be on the skull or backbone fracture that can cause the trauma. It can be a medical procedure or along with the peripheral nerves and the blood or lymphatic system. Okay, saan ba siya nagmula? What is the etiology? So, if the infection is due to pathogen, the culprit might be a virus, a bacterium, a fungus, or a protozoa. Okay, so the causes can be classified into the bacterial infections, viral infections, fungal infections, inflammatory diseases, and cancer, and lead on also on the trauma or to head or spine. So isa-isahin natin yan later on. Okay, so in the pathology, on the pathophysiology, we have the bacteria enters the bloodstream or trauma. So through the infections like the respiratory or ear infections or biotrauma such as skull fracture, once in the bloodstream, these pathogens can travel to the brain. Okay, and then enters to the mucosal surface or cavity because the pathogens often enter through the mucosal surfaces such as the nasal cavity, throat, or sinuses where they can breach local defense mechanism and access the bloodstream or surrounding tissues. Okay, and then there is a breakdown of normal barriers. So the body has a natural barriers. For example, the mucosal barriers, the blood-brain barriers that protect the brain from infections. In meningitis, these barriers are compromised, allowing the pathogen to move closer to the central nervous system. And then we have the down to the process, the blood-brain barrier. So usually it protects the brain from any harmful substances. In meningitis, inflammations and infections weaken the blood-brain barrier, allowing the bacteria, viruses, or other pathogens to enter to the brain CSF. So, and then it enters and proliferates in the CSF. Once the cerebrospinal fluid, the bacteria or virus rapidly multiplies because the CSF is a low immunity environment. So this proliferation leads to the spread of infections in the brain and spinal cord. And then papasok na dyan yung inflammations of the meninges because the immune system responds to the infections that triggering the inflammation in the meninges. So there is the protective membranes around the brain and then the spinal cord. So these inflammations causes classic symptoms like headache, fever, and stiff necks. And then, doon na po papasok yung ating increased intracranial pressure that can causes swelling and accumulation of fluid which increases intracranial pressure. So there is elevated pressure can compress the brain and impair its functions that leading to complications like the seizure, altered consciousness, or coma. Okay, let's talk about the bacterial meningitis. Bacterial meningitis can be a life-threatening and spread between people in close contact. It can be caused by Haemophilus influenza type B. That is the primary cause of meningitis in children. So incidentally, vaccination of children has drastically reduced the incidence of H influenza meningitis. Okay, so di ba sabi nga natin kanina, the bacterial meningitis, that is the septic meningitis. Okay, so extremely serious ito, that is requires immediate care because there can be leading to the permanent damage of the brain or disability or death. So nag-spread through coughing or sneezing. Okay, so ang treatment available natin as per se can be antibiotics as a causative organism. So, kasi nga, diba, the causative agents, we have the Streptococcus pneumoniae, we have the Neisseria meningitis, and Haemophilus influenza. Pag sinabi nating Neisseria meningitis, that is, generally affects the adolescent and is also organism that causes most epidemics of meningitis. Pag dun naman sa Streptococcus pneumoniae, that is a primary etiologic agent in elderly populations. And in the Haemophilus influenza, that is primary cause in the meningitis of the children. Okay? Next, we have the tubercular meningitis. That is TB meningitis caused by what? Mycobacterium tuberculi. Okay, so this is infections with the bacterium begins usually into our lungs. So there is 1-2% of cases the bacteria travel via the bloodstream. Okay, so the TB is not necessarily associated with a particular group because it can causes aggressive type of meningitis that can progress rapidly. Okay. And then, unlike other types of meningitis, it progresses very slowly and symptoms are very big. Okay, so this is the example of droplet infections from the primary focus down to adhesions, vasculitis, or encephalitis. Okay, we have the viral meningitis. So, yung viral meningitis natin, also known as aseptic meningitis, okay, most common than a bacterial form and usually less serious. So yung viral meningitis natin can infect the persons in a two-way. It can be virus that is specifically or directly invades the meninges, or can be result to immune reactions to a virus, does not specifically infect the brain, but is a sort of complications to the viral diseases like the chickenpox, measles, or German measles. So usually dito sa viral meningitis natin, infants younger than 1 month and people with weak immune system are also more likely experience a severe case of meningitis when they acquire. At dito rin po sa viral meningitis natin, tends to be less severe and most people recover completely without the treatment. Kaya kung makikita nyo, yung treatment natin dyan, there is no specific treatment available. Because most patients recover completely on their own. Okay, so ano yung mga causative agents natin? We have the enteroviruses, that is a group of viruses that can cause several infectious diseases that are usually mild. We have the arbovirus, that is also called as arthropod-borne viruses, that is already discussed during our encephalitis. We have the poliovirus, okay, or your poliomyelitis. Pag-uusapan naman natin yan. Kaya na-separate ko yan sa slides. And then we have the mumps virus, the adenovirus, measles virus, and varicella zoster virus. Okay, we have the fungal meningitis. In the fungal meningitis, always remember that rare form of disease. And this is usually occurs in the people who have weakened immune system. Okay, yan lang yung clue nyo pagdating sa fungal meningitis. Ito yung mababa ang kanyang immune system. Okay? Ano mga risk factor natin pagdating sa meningitis? We have the system infections, viral ITI, tobacco use, impaired immune system, and overcrowding. Yan yung usually. Because in overcrowding, there is a zoonotic meningitis that affects people who work or play extensively with the animals as well as the people who live in areas where animals harbor pathogenic bacteria. Okay, how about the immune system? There is an immune deficiency. Individual who do not have a healthy immune system have a higher risk of getting infections of meningitis. An immune deficiency can occur due to the chemotherapy or immunosuppressant medications or any illness that affect the immune system such as HIV or lupus. Okay? So, yan yung mga kwan natin. Another risk factor pa na pwede, it can be abuse of alcohol, have undergone splenectomy, or there has a chronic infections of the middle ear, nose, and sinuses, and also have pneumococcal pneumonia and sickle cell disease. Pagdating sa risk factor in terms of age, certain group are higher risk of becoming infected with meningitis. Paano ba yun? Pag sa babies natin mga anak, are more likely to contract meningitis than older children or adults because of their vaccinations are still incomplete. Pag sa children naman, ang pinag-uusapan, there is a higher risk of contracting meningitis often due to the fact that healthy children have more recurrent infections than healthy adults. And then the elderly, dito na pumapasok, they believe that have the weaker immune system and they may also have the frequent medical visit and hospitalizations, which can increases the exposure to the other people who have contagious infections. Okay, so yan. So vaccinations, seasonal, it can be winter or spring. Clinical manifestation na tayo. In the clinical manifestations for infants, ito, nakikita nyo sa screen, it's already posed. Okay, so yan yung makikita natin. But always remember there is a hallmark in our encephalitis. Ang hallmark natin palagi in our meningitis. Sa meningitis, ang hallmark natin, we have the fever, severe headache, and stiffness of the neck. Yan yung pakikitandaan nyo pagdating sa meningitis. Yung hallmark niya, tatlo lang. So, fever, severe headache, and stiffness of the neck. Ito naman po yung adults, kung makikita nyo, yan po yung kanilang signs and symptoms. Okay, so ito, pag-usapan natin itong Kehrig signs. Yung Kehrig sign natin, that is severe stiffness of the hamstring causes an inability to strengthen the leg when the hip is flexed to the 90 degree. So that is Kehrig signs. Okay, that is named after the Russian neurologist Waldemar Kehrig. Sorry, there is a typo error there, that is Kehrig sign. The test is positive when the thigh is flexed at the hip and the knee at the 90% angle and subsequent extension in the knee is painful, that is leading to the resistance. This may indicate the subarachnoid hemorrhage or meninges. So that is for Kehrig sign. How about Brudzinski sign? Pag Brudzinski sign that is named after by Joseph Brudzinski, that is English neurologist. The test is done by putting the patient flat on bed and the clinician then attempts to flex the head over the chest. The knee are flexly drawn upward and up. Okay? And then hindi ko na nailagay, we have the office totonus, that is the spasm of the muscle of the back causing the head and the lower limbs to bend backward and the trunk of the arm forward. So yon. So punta naman tayo sa assessment and diagnosis. Paulit-ulit lang kasi this is a central nervous system. So pare-parehas lang po tayo ng assessment. From history taking, physical assessment, CT and MRI, blood culture and sensitivity, and we have the lumbar puncture. So dito natin ginagawa yung mga yun. So this is the normal CSF findings. As you can see, from normal, bacterial, viral, and fungal. Kasi yung cerebrospinal fluid natin can be secured through the lumbar puncture, also known as the spinal tap. This is a medical procedure, mga anak, in which a needle is inserted into the spinal canal and most commonly to collect cerebrospinal fluid. Yun po yung ginagawa natin into CSF. Okay, medical management. Punta tayo sa medical management, bacterial meningitis. So andyan naman po, we have the cefotaxime or ceftriaxone, and then vancomycin is added in the regime in case of resistance. Kasi minsan may mga drug resistance tayo, kaya meron tayong mga nakaline na drugs in terms of the meningitis. Next, we have dexamethasone. Dehydration and shock can be treated with fluid therapy. For the seizure management, we have penipoint. Okay, how about in tubercular meningitis? Okay, so ATT medications are started. So yan, parang usually mga anak, kung ano po yung drugs natin sa tuberculosis, same with true with our tubercular meningitis. But it depends upon our pulmonologist kung ano yung ibibigay nila. Kaya nga in children, importante ang BCG. That is vaccine offer, di ba? Kasi that is approximately mga nag 64% protective effect yan. Kaya nga, di ba, yung BCG, Bacilli Calmette Guarine, that is anti-TB, binibigay siya at birth. Kaya maganda po ito. Next, we have the viral meningitis. Yung viral meningitis natin usually naman that is supportive and no medications as prescribed. So magkakaroon lang tayo ng losarazepam or barbiturate for the seizure prophylaxis. Ganun pa rin, increase ICP, mannitol pa rin. So same pa rin siya. Paulit-ulit lang kung ano yung ginawa natin doon sa una kanina kasi nga we're talking about on the central nervous system. Okay, so in case of hydrocephalus naman, prevent BP or LP shunt is required. So, antipyretic kapag nilalagnat, antiemetics yung iba pang ibibigay natin. Okay, nursing management, this is the very important thing na ginagawa natin because we are all nurses and we need to do this one. Okay, so usually we need to assess neurologic conditions of our patients. So we need to observe his or her level of consciousness and check for the signs of increased intracranial pressure. Yun ang pinakaimportante dito na in term of meningitis. I-check natin yung signs ng ICP. Usually, tinitignan natin yung plucking at bed covers, vomiting, pwede siyang projectile, or seizure, or there is a changes in motor functions and vital signs. Okay, so these are the some example again of nursing diagnosis. Yan, kapag pinagawa na kayo sa inyong mga duty, makikita nyo, this is are the sample. So kung mayroon naman kayo nanda, you can see there on your book. Next, ito pa po, sample po yan mga yan. So, naglagay na rin po ako para hindi po tayo mahirapan sooner pag gumawa po tayo ng nursing care plan. Okay, kailangan natin dito sa meningitis maintain the respiratory functions. Why? We need to assess respiratory rate and the quality frequently. Monitor natin yung perfusions with pulse oximetry. Monitor the patient for respiratory insufficiency and ventilator support or oxygen system. So, yan yung kailangan natin i-check. Kasi nga, kailangan po natin na makita yung ating patient. So, watch for deteriorations of our patient's conditions which may signal for an impending crisis. Kaya importante po iyon. Okay, ano pa? Chest physiotherapy for elevation of the head of the bed, monitor vital signs and functioning. So, ano pa? Reducing the effects of physical immobility. Anong pwede natin gawin? We change the positions every 2 hours. If there is a paralyzed extremities, anong gagawin? Support a functionals positions and range of motion exercise every 2 hours and use of the comfort devices. Next, we have adequate nutrition and hydration. Siyempre naman, maintain po natin yun. Use of elastic stacking, massage, and hygiene maintenance. Okay. Nutritional support naman natin. Ito, naka-flash on your screen. This is important also to giving to our patients. So balikan ko lang naka doon sa position, the position the patient carefully to prevent stiffness and neck pain. So turn him or her open to avoid pressure sores and respiratory complications. So assist with range of motions exercises. Okay? So ganito pa rin, assess for the return of the gag reflex and bowel sounds before resuming the oral nutritions kasi magkukwadin tayo dito yung ensure our patient's comfort. Okay. We need also to improve the communication. So like lip reading, use of picture card, speech therapy, give pen and paper. Yan po yung pan natin. And then, relieving the fear and anxiety. Importante po yan. We need to provide providing information about the patient's conditions. We need also give a positive appraisal, encouraging relaxations, exercises, and positive impact. And syempre, we clear their doubts and manage pain with analgesic and diversions therapy. Sabi ko nga, provide reassurance and support to the patients and then the family and follow the strict aseptic technique when treating the patients with head wounds or skull fractures. If necessary, mga anak, isolation is necessary, especially if there is a nasal culture is positive. So, yan lang po yung tatandaan po natin. Tingnan nyo, very detailed na po dito sa ating meningitis. So, yan po.